So the Steart Coastal Management Project was on the Steart Peninsula, which is the end of the Parrett Estuary. It involved turning 477 hectares of agricultural land into intertidal habitat. And the objectives for this was primarily driven by the European Union's directive for providing compensatory habitat for salt marsh loss due to effectively sea level rise.
The Steart Coastal Management Project was the Environment Agency's flagship project, not only in the region but in the UK, and I believe it is a world-class project. From the EA's perspective, we were very happy with the results and the outcomes of the project. We exceeded expectations, I believe. All the outcomes and objectives were achieved. We managed to come in on time and within budget, and on site there were no lost time accidents or environmental incidents.
So our role at Steart is the ongoing management, the community engagement, and we very much see ourselves as custodians of the Steart Marshes site. WWT are incredibly proud because, you know, it's been such a huge success. The partnerships have worked really, really well, and we're proud of what it's achieving, what it has achieved, what it's developed into, and also to continue being involved with the management. It's massively exciting. And it's become an incredibly important wetland and probably one of our most successful large-scale landscape projects.
We're 9 years now after the breach, and it keeps getting better. It's always a surprise when you go there just how good it is. You know, the visitor numbers keep going up. You know, it's just obvious when you go there. It's an absolutely magical place.
So Jacob brought to the project a team of specialists to integrate coastal and terrestrial engineers, ecologists, specialists in landscape, geotechnical, and many other disciplines to create something that worked for the environment and for the client.
A few years after we had built Steart, we were part of a research day organised by WWT, the Wildfowl and Wetland Trust, which brought various researchers together. And at one of those workshops, I met some colleagues from Manchester Metropolitan University who had been working on wetland restoration for some years, like ourselves. But they were now working on carbon storage in these sites.
I'm Dr. Hannah Mossman. I'm a senior lecturer in ecology at Manchester Metropolitan University.
Salt marshes are different from forests because, you know, it's quite easy to see the carbon that's stored in a forest. There's a trunk, isn't there? There's some leaves. It's really obvious. Whereas coastal habitats like seagrasses and salt marshes store the carbon underneath the ground. So it's harder for us all to envisage because it's kind of stored in the mud itself. And so what this thing is called blue carbon is carbon that's stored in seagrasses and salt marshes, mangroves, in tropical areas. And so unlike forests, where you can see the carbon in the trunk of the trees, the carbon in blue carbon habitats is under the ground. So really it shouldn't be blue carbon, it should probably be grey carbon because it's the carbon in the mud. And we've probably neglected this topic for a long time as researchers and as kind of climate scientists. So potentially these blue carbon habitats, so salt marshes and seagrasses, potentially can store enormous amounts of carbon. So they have quite a small area. So you imagine the whole of the Amazon forest is very big, and these salt marsh habitats are very small because they can only be around the coastline of the country. But per unit area, they can actually store more carbon than that tropical forest. And that's why it's really exciting. So per unit area, they can actually store more carbon than the Amazon forest. But obviously they're confined to the coastline, so we have less of them than we do of the big forests of the world. So Steart's really exciting because beforehand, before our work at Steart, we knew that salt marshes stored carbon in the UK, but the amounts that we were seeing were quite low. At Steart, we found that in the first 6 years, it stored 25,000 tonnes of organic carbon, which is the equivalent to the electricity used by 18,000 homes in 1 year. Enormous amounts of carbon in just the first 6 years. So there's a great potential and we're really excited by that.
In order to calculate how many carbon credits that you might gain from a project that you've undertaken specifically to store carbon, you need to follow an approved methodology, and these are called carbon codes or carbon verification methodologies. Now, we have such codes in the UK for woodland areas and we have them for peatland areas, but we don't have one yet for salt marshes. Jacob's developed, in collaboration with others, one of the first wetland carbon codes back in 2014. This was in Louisiana, so at the same time as we were developing the Steart Coastal Marshes project in the UK, our colleagues in the US were already beginning to think about blue carbon.
Definitely, there will be more steerts. We have all sorts of visitors. So we've got our day-to-day visitors who come for recreation, health and well-being, walking their dogs. But then we also get politicians coming to the site, and we get a lot of construction workers coming to the site to look at the design. The design is really quite special at Steart. So I think people are seeing wetlands as a wondrous solution to all of these problems that we're facing, and then they want to copy it. So in terms of design and just managed realignment, I would say absolutely this is being seen as a something else that's going to be replicated all over the UK.
It's always exciting and probably stressful to be at the forefront of science. For me, this science is actually able to make changes. So this is reinforcing our idea of creating new habitat. And for me, that's what's really important. I'm a scientist that wants my work to be useful. I don't want to be set in my lab, in my ivory tower, not making an impact on the world. So I want my science to be useful. And so this is an opportunity that I'm really happy with, because it means that something can come from my science. And that's what's really exciting for me.
For my part, I'm really pleased to be doing these projects, hopefully leaving the world in a little bit better place than when I arrived.